ਵਾਹਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਕਾ ਖਾਲਸਾ, ਵਾਹਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਕੀ ਫਤਿਹ। ਵੈਲਕਮ ਟੂ ਦਿਸ ਇੰਟਰੋਡਕਸ਼ਨ ਆਫ ਦ ਵੀਡੀਓ ਸੀਰੀਜ਼ ਆਫ ਜਪਜੀ ਇਨ ਪ੍ਰੈਪਰੇਸ਼ਨ ਫੋਰ ਦ ਯੂਰੋਪੀਅਨ ਯੋਗਾ ਫੈਸਟੀਵਲ। ਆਈ ਐਮ ਗੋਇੰਗ ਟੂ ਗੋ ਥਰੂ ਅ ਲਿਟਲ ਬਿਟ ਆਫ ਐਨ ਇੰਟਰੋਡਕਸ਼ਨ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਦ ਜਪਜੀ, ਐਂਡ ਦਿਸ ਵਿਲ ਬੀ ਫੋਲੋਡ ਓਵਰ ਦ ਡੇਜ਼ ਬਾਈ ਡਿਫਰੈਂਟ ਟੀਚਰਸ ਇੰਟਰੋਡਿਊਸਿੰਗ ਈਚ ਆਫ ਦ ਪੌੜੀਜ਼ and going into more details. I'm Shiv Charan Singh. I live in Portugal and I'm part of the Guru Ram Das Ashram community here. So I'm very grateful for this opportunity and honor to introduce this Japji course. And I'm not claiming here to have any special scholastic knowledge or understanding or linguistic mastery over the Japji, but I do love the Japji very much. My first encounter with the Japji made it very clear that this is the pool that I want to drink from, the philosophy, let's say, the principles that I want to guide my life by. So I'm very grateful to Guru Nanak for his words, for the Shabda Guru. I'm not going to go into the history, the historical context of what was happening in India at that time, the social, the political, the religious scene. The message of Japji is timeless. We say, Ad such, God such, He be such, Nanak hosi be such. So it's not about especially that context. It was relevant then, relevant there, is relevant now and here, and it will be relevant in the future. So let's focus more on the message of the Japji. It's a message about the Creator, Ekankar, the Creator of all the creation, all the worlds, upper realms, lower realms. It's a message about our place as individuals, the place of the individual soul within that creation. And it's also a message about the journey that each soul is making through the time and space, through the Maya. It's a call to consciousness, the consciousness of Guru Nanak, the consciousness that the words of the Shabda Guru represent. The Japji is inviting us to enter in and participate in that consciousness. It's a map, in a way, also, to that supreme state, a map to excellence. I think of it as walking with Nanak. As I read the Japji, meditate on the Japji, align myself to the Japji, learning to think and to feel as Nanak. Those of you who know the 10 spiritual bodies know that the first spiritual body is represented also in the life of Guru Nanak and his embodiment of the virtue of humility. So there's a Shakti and a Bhakti in it, and then just that devotion, that just read it as it is, go into it with your heart. And there's a passion of the Shabda Guru, the quantum technology, and how that resets or reformats our psyche. It takes the idea, Ekankar, and it takes you through the poetry, through the feeling of the truth of that, and it eventually becomes embodied and manifested in action. Nanak. What's the meaning of the name Nanak? Let's briefly look at that. Nanak. Nuk is a nose. No nose. And that's the humility. Nuk also means easy. So Nanak means it's not an easy path. These are different expressions I've heard from different Sikh scholars and teachers along the way. Na Anak. Anak is many. Na Anak, not many, but one, which is Ik. Na Na Ik. Never say no to the one in everything and the one in everyone. Guru Nanak said, if you want to walk on this path of love, put your head in your hands and make an offering of your head, and disregard the public opinion. We know that we're very affected by the pressure, the social policing and the social media, this noise of what other people say and think. So it is indeed not easy to hold steady in the middle part of the life. Put your head in your hands. It also means, because the head is where you think. So why we give our head is meaning not no head, but it means if I think, I think like Nanak. This is just my understanding. So, walking with Nanak, becoming Nanak, when we read, Nanak says, at the end of the Puri, it will say often that Nanak says this and this and this. Well, right now, that's you saying that. So that means you are Nanak, you are becoming Nanak. It is awakening that quality of Nanak inside of you. You're opening into and stepping into that same state. Here's a very lovely quote from Sri Singh Sabh Yogi Bhajan. He says this, yeah? Guru Bani says, come to me, come in me, take me in you and recite me, respond to me. Recite me in that response, and I'll give you what I gave to Nanak. This is the idea. Come to me, be within me, and I'll be within you. And when you recite it, and you recite it from within you, it will be as Nanak recited it. As I came through Nanak, I'll come through you. So this is the invitation, really, of Japji. And the japa, japa, ja means go, pa means obtain, realize, become, become that which Nanak has given and what Nanak has described and shared. I feel it like I entrust myself to the Shabda Guru and the Shabda Guru will entrust itself to me. Just like you might have seen that we carry the Sri Guru Granth Sahib on the head to take it into the Gurdwara, or take it into the Sukhasana in the evening. And so this is a downpouring of the Shabda Guru, of that primary intelligence, that mystical wisdom coming into our being. Although it's associated to a religion, it's actually part of the spiritual inheritance of humanity. It's extremely intelligent. It's beautiful poetry. And there are many truths to reflect upon. It wakes up that deep reflection in us, our spiritual DNA. And the mind becomes quiet and clear and intuition can function. Your body, as you allow that to pour through you, you breathe it, it gets into your blood, moves through your whole body. Your body becomes a temple of your spirit. There are many themes in Japji overlapping each other, like waves coming up on the ocean, another wave is passing down, another wave rising, high waves, lower waves, deeper waves, many undercurrents to take you into the depth of your being. So we can study the Japji into different frames of reference, let's say. The gunas as a journey from tamaguna, Rajaguna, Sattvaguna, into the fourth state, Turiya. We can understand it through the tattvas. Different puris maybe have different reference to the tattvas. A journey from the earth to the ethers, like the five senses, five tattvas, transforming through pratyahara, the thieves of the five senses become helpers, guide us on our way. It's a description of the soul's experience and perception of the cosmos through the different steps on the ladder, like the kundalini rising through the chakras. That would be another way to study the Japji. A very profound way, as we are spirits having a human experience, would then be to associate it to the 10 spiritual bodies. And that the journey through to the excellence and through to the radiant body is described actually through the Japji. And prior to that, it's actually already there in the Mool Mantra. It's quite remarkable, actually, how when Guru Nanak spoke the Mool Mantra, he was actually describing not only the qualities of the divine, the qualities of God, but also the latent qualities within us to become also those qualities. And further than that, each of the successive gurus after Nanak, they also embodied each of those stages of the Mumantra. So Guru Nanak explores this transcendent unity of the divine, but also in its immanent expression. This is what we call Nirgun and Sargun. Nirgun, no qualities, Sargun, in every quality. That the creation is the body of God. And Guru Nanak is inviting us to recognize this reality and the consistency of this reality in all contexts. And as we may recognize, that is not always easy. There are many challenges on the way. And the Mool Mantra is like the calibrating reference to bring that alignment of the mind. It is the bij, it is the seed idea of Ekongkar, the roots through the Mool Mantra, and then the tree and the branches and the flowers and the fruit unfolding through the rest of the japji. So, as we said, the many themes, and not going to go into all that detail now, but we'll take a little walk with Nanak and through the japji sahib, on focusing this particularly on action. Now, let's try that out as a thread to follow through the japji. A little interesting correspondence here. You might have heard of the Four Noble Truths of Buddha, that we suffer, that we suffer because of our craving, because of a state of desire. There is a way to resolve that suffering, and that way is the Dharma. Four simple truths, we call it. So actually, Guru Nanak starts out saying more or less something similar. Bhukya bhukna utre te panna puryabhad. The hunger continues even however much we accumulate. So Guru Nanak asks this question, give sacharo hoye, give kure tutipal, how can this veil of falsehood, of maya, of this delusion, how can we see through this to the reality? Because all our efforts of our own mind, they just show how foolish we are in a way. The more we try to engage and resolve the problem, sometimes we just create 10 more. So Guru Nanak then begins the answer, and he says, there's a hukam. Hukam rajai chalana, Nanak likhya na. Chalana, go walk with hukam. Nanak likhya na, with is written deep within us, actually. It's right here. But we need to dive deep to feel it, to know it. Hukam, the command, or the divine order, the creative, mystical intelligence that's inherent in everything. Order is an interesting word. Order like a command, order like organization, how things are ordered. So this hukam, God's hukam, is actually giving order to everything. And if we listen deeply to the natural laws and follow that wisdom, then we're taking the order as an order, taking the way things are naturally organized, taking it as a command, and aligning with that. So Guru Nanak describes how this hukam is all pervading. Everything happens because of hukam. And then if somebody would understand hukam, there would be no home, no ego. Home is meaning me, me, the egoistic illusion that I am the doer, ahankar, I do everything, when really there's one doer of all things through hukam. Now this raises a little question of free will. Oh, so there's nothing I can do, everything is just predetermined. Here's an interesting analogy that I heard also from another Sikh. The analogy of a train with different carriages. Now we're not the driver of the train. We are in each in our world, our little story, our drama, our family, our village, our little groups. We're all in our various carriages. And in that carriage, you've got a lot of space to play around. You can sleep, you can play games on your computer, you can talk to your friends, you can argue with somebody, you can look out the window, where have we been? You can look out the window, turn around the other way, where are we going? And according to how we live the life, we are, this is written in the slog, near or far, karani apo apani, by our actions. We are more near, close to the driver, close to the sense of what's actually making all this happen, or far. Karma, up and by our own actions. So yes, action does count. Yes, we have some freedom of movement, but we can't stop the train. Train will go where the train will go. So this is an interesting analogy of recognizing the boundaries of our free will. At the same time, as I'm highlighting now, the Japji does give references that tell us that action is important. Okay, we'll follow that through. Through hukam, God is a giver of all things. This is also written at least three or four times through the Japji. Guru Nanak reminds us, God is a giver. There's one giver. Everything is given by God. That can turn your attention to seva. When you do seva, when you give to somebody, you're really just the channel of God giving. But seva and giving is very important because it wakes up the God in you. We could say giving is being godly. And then Guru Nanak asks, what to give the giver? How can you give the one who has all and who gives all? Okay, so here is where praise of God, remembrance of God comes in. But first we need to see the context. So by this, showing this limitation, where our action counts and where we are without power to actually act. So we get the right sense of perception, right proportion of where we are. What is this time and space in this earth during in the Kali Yuga time? Okay, our actions are actually impacting us. Karma aave kapara nadri mok dwar. By our karma, we have this cover of the body, and it's through grace, the driver, that we can be liberated. The line before that, interesting one, Amrita Vela Satchana Vadiyavicha. Rise in the Amrita Vela and give praise to God. So this is action, because action does count. So, Gavye, Sunya, Man, Kita, Bha. This is an interesting summary. Listen and follow in your mind this understanding of the Shambhu Guru. Interesting now the contrast of Gurumukh and Manmukh. Mukh, mouth, mukh, your face. Turn to the Guru. Speak what the Guru speaks. Manmukh is linked to that homai or ahankar. I speak my own mind, my opinion, my view about the things. Speak, but speak what? What should guide you in your speaking? Through singing the praises of God, we come to understand. Sabana ka ek data some visarana jai. Everything, there's one giver to all, sabana all. And then some visarana jai, may I not forget that. Basically, that's it. Maya is a hypnotic force that draws us in. Maya is not necessarily an illusion, but it produces in us an illusory effect. Misconceptions, distortions of our perception. Maya has this impact on us. And how can we clear this veil of distortion? Okay, let's continue. Jeti sirit upai veka vin karma ke milele. Action has consequence. And without action, nothing can be achieved. So again, this is written in the Pauris of the Japji, telling us that action is absolutely significant, and we have to see within the time and space how we can live that. Now, hukam is to listen. Guru Nanak, in a way, gives a command here. Said, listen. He doesn't say see. Seeing is searching, and sometimes searching, we get lost in the search. We even get blinded by the search. It doesn't say look. It doesn't even say feel, smell, taste, or touch, but listen. That's an action. Nanak bhakta saravega sunya duk pap ka nas. Those who listen are always in a blossoming state. And then comes another four qualities that tell us mane. What is meaning here? Respectfully obey. Jeko man jane man koi. Whoever will respectfully obey, having listened deeply, they will come to understand. And mane is sometimes interpreted as faith. If I listen and I have faith, of course I obey, I follow what I have listened. Interesting, some of you know the sequence, obey, serve, love, excel. So here's another way, another frame of reference. Reading through the Japti, now comes having understood that there is hukam, there is command, there's a divine intelligence. And then Guru Nanak is asking, listen to that, listen to it. And then there's no good listening if we will not follow what we hear. Respectfully obey and enjoy the fruits of that. So the obedience implies this kind of allegiance or alignment to that hukam. We're in the carriage, but don't try to argue with where the train driver is taking us in a way. Now, this is not easy. So we hear, all this creation, kudrat, what can I say? Even to sacrifice myself, to offer myself to that, is not an easy thing to be doing. Panchparvan, panchparadan, but if I take my five senses and work with that within the carriage that I have, then something can happen in the midst of all these obstacles. Dwal dharam dhyakaput. Dharam, dharma. Where there's dharma, there's no karma. So this bull of compassion gives birth to the child of dharma. So again, action, which kind of action? Dharma action. Karmic actions are habits. They're hardly even actions, they're just habits that we live automatically and that we are a slave to. A dharma habit is a carriage, it's something that carries my soul through the journey. It serves me on my journey. Same carriage, but I can live it as a karma, live it as a dharma. Bharyan mat papa ke sang o dope nabe ke ranga. We need to clean the mind. Just like you wash clothes with soap, wash the mind with the japa, with the simran of nam. So again, action. Now this doesn't mean just being like a parrot, repeating without thinking about what you're doing. Kar kar karna likle jaho ape bij ape hi kaho. It's an action that is done repeatedly and sinks deeply within us. Okay, sowing seed, ape bij ape hiko. As you sow the seed, you will harvest. You will end up eating that. Karka karane likle, whatever is done again and again shall go deep within you. So doing the japa of your dharma. And we go on. When gun kite bhagat na hoye, guna implies virtues. Bhakti doesn't arrive in our heart. Like we said, it's not just a parrot repetition, but with the bhakti and with the technology of shakti, using your navi, this practice, okay, is going to lead to virtue. Living a life of virtue awakens the bhakti. Bhakti moves us to live a life of virtue. Action is implied. Nadya ativaha pav simandana janya. We are on that journey. We are like, each soul is going like a river to the samunda, samunda, the ocean. But we don't know how vast the ocean is. So we don't have to try to analyze. It's describing the indescribable. Why should we do that? Focus on that journey. the river to the ocean. There is this. You see, one version of the spiritual life, this need, this desire, this longing, is something terrible. It's sinful. It makes us do terrible things. Therefore, we should oppress it, deny it, cut it off, disconnect from it, and just be up in the clouds of spirituality. But this is not authentic. Rather, we talk about emotion to devotion, the longing to belong. The river must reach the ocean. So it's really harnessing this passion in us and bringing it to the heart. And this is bhakti. Bhakti leads to seva. Seva means a living of the virtues. So over and again, there's a references to action and which quality of action. What we do as well as how we do it and the attitude with which we do it. Attitude implying here also not forget the giver. So not taking special credit. I have achieved, I did my dharma. I said, thank you God, you gave me the blessing to remember and live by the dharma, to awaken the bhakti inside of me. And this remembrance, a very important thing. So this is attitude in our action, yeah? That even suffering actually is also seen as a blessing. It contains wisdom. There are lessons to learn. So learning, listening to the lessons of life also. Munda santok sarampad joli. This is interesting. Again, implied action. Which kind of action? Practice contentment, modesty. Contain, restrain. Remember death. Keep your body clean and remain in faith. Simple, simple guidelines the Guru is giving here. And gain this right understanding. Now we want to get to the front of the train. There's a poetry about that, about the even this little worm wants to climb the ladder. One tongue will become a thousand tongues reciting over and again, and every cell is like one tongue, and these 33 trillion cells and Ang Sang Wahi Guru reciting. And this aspiration of the consciousness to rise and get closer to the divine, to the driver, climbing that ladder. And then comes a puri saying, but what power have we? We don't have power to be silent. We don't have power to speak, to beg, to give, to die, to live, to gather wealth or gyan, mystical knowledge. Without the hand, jis habjur, in whose hand is all that power? Without that hand, there's nothing we can do. But this doesn't say you can't act. Action has consequences. This is very important to get this right balance. What is the limit of my action? Don't try to do what I can't do. Don't try to control what I can't control. But recognize action counts. It's not for me to control anybody else's life, but to manage this vehicle. Tis vich dharti tap raki dharamasau. In the middle of all the time and space, has put the dharti, the earth, as a place of a dharma sal, sala, a court of dharma. Here we get karmi karmi hoi vichara. Here we get vichara means reflect on the action and reaction, the law of cause and effect, to see the results of our actions, to learn and to grow. If we don't see it here, it will be rather shocking when we leave this life and we see our life movie and with a lot of connections we're going to make and say, oh, why didn't I see that? Because I was living life as karma and I didn't realize, no, this is the place to reflect on karma. Karmi, karmi, hoi vichar, reflect on the karma. Ketya karma bhumi mer kete kete du abhides. In another puri, the next puri. This is saying there are many lessons to learn. So it's just confirmation again. Many karmas, many actions, many fields of action, and many chances to learn. And many teachers, many contexts of teachings. And through this, we can transform our consciousness. Tete garye surat mat man bud. Garye means to go through this reformulation of Surat, Mat, Man, and Buddha, different aspects of our consciousness and intelligence. In the 38th Puri, Jatapahara, Dirisunyar, Heran, Mata, Ved, Hatyar, again, even though it's telling us the limits of our power, Jor, but still we can practice restraint, patience, applied intelligence, the hammer and chisel of right understanding. Breathe with that awe, that fear of God, that state of, wow, the fire of discipline of Dharma in the heart's crucible of love. This alchemy happened by right action. Some alchemy happens and this mint, this coin of mystical gold is produced. We're going to the radiant body here, yeah? The radiance of this gold. It is indescribable. And Nanak has achieved this amazing thing. So he has spoken the unspeakable. He has described the indescribable through his poetry, through these waves upon waves of different messages coming through, through the quantum technology of the spiritual DNA awakening, through the invitation to bhakti, and through the right understanding of action. Then we come to, finally, we might remember we mentioned the tattvas, yeah, the five tattvas and the harmonization of the tattvas and the senses through the tattvas. Pavanguru, Pani, Pita, Mata, Dharat, Mahatta, Pavan, the air, Pani, the water, Dharata, the earth. Now where is fire? Kadami, Apo, Apani. The fire is in your action. Action is a molding, like fire can destroy, but destroy what? The fire of purification. Fire is molding. Make the clay, put it in the oven, you fix it. By repeated actions, remember that, by repeated actions, something is set. Karmi apo apni ke nere ke dur. You are more near or far to the driver, the hookum of the driver within you and in everything in your environment. So there are many things we have no power of, but changyaya buryaya, the merits and our demerits, the virtues and the vices of our actions are subject to dharma. Dharma is meaning that the natural justice, really, the law of natural justice, everything gets weighed and measured, not by our mind's value, what I think is right, what I think is wrong, what I think is better, what I think is worse, but actually by the natural laws of justice. Our actions are put in the measure of that. And then we can move along the carriages in a new incarnation, getting closer day by day, and lifetime by lifetime, into that contact connectedness to the driver. In the five khandas, the five realms, khandas, that are described a little earlier in Japji Sahib, the fourth and the fifth one, Karma Khand and Sat Khand. Such is that eternal reality. Remember, Ad Such, God Such is always there. In the Karma Khand, this is describing how, having gone through the different work of the Dharma Sala, working out the Dharma, reflecting on the law of karma, learning the lessons we have to learn, reshaping our understanding. And in this way, we enter into the fourth realm, perhaps linked to the fourth state, Turiya, state of consciousness. There's this nearness to the divine. In that domain, you cannot die, you cannot be cheated, you are intimate with the divine. So it's quite interesting that these two descriptions of the fourth and the fifth realm don't have a number separating them, like one puri, one step, another step. Stepping into the heart, stepping into neutral mind, number four, stepping into the fourth realm of grace, of karma, of kindness, we are in that nearness to the divine. The alchemy has become complete and the coin, the gold, has been prepared. And now, Nanak te, remember we said it's not easy. Jinni naam dhyaya, gema shakata gaal, effort has had to have been made. to deeply reflect on Naam, on your true identity, Satnam. And then Nanak te muk ujjalet, so this radiance, the radiant body is opening up within us and the emanations. And then there's a seva even continues there, that in the life you become an inspiration to others, and even on departure of this life, keti chutinal, other souls who are lost in the astral planes can find their way with you as you go through the realms. Here we are, we've come to the end of this introduction to Japji. It's very important to understand that this Nanak te muk ujjalet is not an ego state, it's a result. It's not something we say, oh yeah, I want to do that. If you just be virtuous, be honest, be sincere, work on step by step, do the japa, any steps you miss because you are distracted in any way, so we do japa, we go through it again, go through it again. This is the result. We think of the numbers 1 to 9 and then 10. 10 is the target. You hit the target and there's a radiance. It's a result. Simran, seva, they have this result. A few little tips as you go on in your study of the Japji. It is important to look for different translations and study the meaning. Not just recite in good faith, of course, but do reflect on the meaning. Learn to practice good rhythm and pronunciation. Listen to good recordings. Ideally, would be really worth it. It's a meditation in itself to learn to read Gurumukhi. Hold it here when you're reading the Japji. Don't be leaning down upon it. Keep up, heart open, chest open. Hold it there so the bhakti is present. Hear yourself as you recite. Hear the sound. Hear Nanak speaking in you. And no matter what, there'll be days when it's boring, days when you don't even remember if you read it, other days when it's very exciting. Just keep, go through it again and again and again. And from time to time, find a line, find one line and just really let it jump out at you and just stay with it and walk around it in many ways and find how it brings you back to clarity again and again. This we call the Gatka line. One line that can just cut you from nonsense, from your drama, from the ego distractions, and just, hey, remember, because big problem is this, we forget. So Nanak prays, may I never forget. Bless you all, wish you a good journey with walking with Nanak, and that you arrive to that consciousness that you may never forget. Waheguru Ji Ka Khalsa. Waheguru Ji Ki Fateh.